This was a story that we're not going to hit on all of it because we want to get to the part where what we found out is going on here. So we're going to get back to my guest. Go ahead.
So anyway, under case number C-217569 in Department 3, Judge Douglas Herndon, on February the 9th, granted me the time served and had me sign an Alford plea. Now, this is very important to understand. All of a sudden, I get on the witness stand and I'm talking about these Nevada revised statutes in my writ of habeas corpus because I told the judge, you must hear all of my grounds in my habeas corpus because that's what this hearing is, evidentiary hearing, is about. He stopped me and said, Mr. Walters, he said, bailiff, take Mr. Walters back to the holding cell. Counsel, I'll see you and the DA in my office, in my chambers. Well, I don't know if they left the courtroom or not because I didn't have a chance to find out because they cuffed me up and they took me back into the holding cell. While I'm in this cell, about a half hour later, my attorney comes back in, Joshua Thompson. He says, I got great news for you. The state wants to make a deal right now. I said, what's the deal? He said, they want to give you the Alford plea, which means you don't have to admit to guilt. And they're going to reassign a new crime. Now listen to this, reassign a new crime.
So they knew what you had, and all of a sudden everybody started backing away.
That's right. Okay. So now they're going to reassign me a new crime, and here's the crime. We're going to get you, even though it's an Alford plea, the state could probably prove this or not prove it. We're going to get you to accept, since you already got 8.5 years in, they're going to give you an 8 to 20. And they're going to give you two of those, and they're going to run them concurrent. And it's going to be for owning and possessing of a financial forgery laboratory.
You got to be kidding me.
Now, I've never been charged, indicted on the crime or nothing. So they wiped out all the other ones. They gave me the Alford plea and said, now, you don't have to admit to guilt to it. Oh, but we got to get you to sign an amended indictment. And you're going to agree that if the amendment indictment has any deficiencies, you're going to waive those deficiencies. Now, from my legal mind and research, I happen to know that when you have a constitutionally an unlawful constitutional law that fails, it doesn't matter what you signed because you can never waiver a consent to it. And I think Vinny would have to agree with that, okay, as an attorney and an enforcement in New York. So anyway, I took the deal. He gave me 2,860 days credit time served. And I'm going to get to what's the important thing for these viewers to understand because it's starting to come out now.
Okay, good. Yeah,
so
this,
this is
what we're waiting for. They're sitting on the end of their seat.
I'm getting ready to give you something that these people will never believe. So anyway, on the course of that 8.5 years, I stayed busy, not only fighting my case, but I've gotten over 200 other inmates out of prison, some that are doing life, that committed murders they didn't even do. They were
convicted of murder, right, that they didn't even do.
Freddie Neese spent 27 years, they call him Shaggy, in prison before he met me. I packaged his deal. I showed that he was at a train station with a video that was suppressed in Philadelphia at the train station with the train ticket the day they said he did a murder. And everybody along the way have given up on this man, and he became institutionalized until I became his cellie. And after he saw me helping people in there and doing the litigate work for them as an inmate advocate on the yard, he turned around and asked me if I'd look at his stuff. 1 year later, Freddie Neese is released. And I'm happy for him. Excuse me, I get a little choked up
about it. That's
it.
Let me tell you something. You're all hot, so that's okay. It's okay because you have no idea the disaster that the people of Nye County are going through. Well, you have an idea because you lived it. But the average listener doesn't really know what is going on in the court system. You're the person that lived it. So if you get choked up, we understand, and don't worry about it.
I raised the unlawful and unconstitutional issues in the writ of habeas corpus on the NRS statutes. And Judge Herndon, he did all he could do to not allow to expand the record. They will never, ever let any inmate or any person in jail come to expand the record on this issue, because if they do, they're going to have to free up thousands and thousands of inmates, and the 12 that they unlawfully, unconstitutionally, illegally killed since they reinstated the death penalty in 1977, 12 people went to the death by laws that constitutionally unlawfully fail and don't exist.
So what you're saying in a roundabout way, The people that are in jail in the state of Nevada need to get retried.
They either need new trials or they need to be released. And I'm going to tell you, I'm going to refer to this.
Gary, under what statute should they get a new trial? The NRS is not legit.
Well, here's the thing. When you have a constitutionally unlawfully failed statute, the court lacks subject matter jurisdiction, which can be raised at any time. It has no procedural bars or latches to it. And subject matter jurisdiction, the court never had because of the proven unlawful and unconstitutional laws that failed from the creation and inception of them. We went right to the horse's head and cut it off, shall I say. We went to the creation and the inception of how the NRSs were created and how the statutes in Nevada were repealed. Now, when you repeal a statute, I don't care who you are, walking and living or otherwise, you can never revive it. It's gone forever. What do you say?
You got to say it a little bit louder, Vin, because we're having a hard time.
Has the term accepted practice ever come up during your research?
I have reviewed the word accepted practice, okay? The same as I reviewed the uniformity of law and all those other issues. And I can concur with you on some of these issues. Now, let me explain something. If the court lacks subject matter jurisdiction to ever proceed, your crime vanishes. I don't care what you did. However, crime and punishment must be adhered to and administered in the state or any state. We must have a system that balances fair punishment and fair crimes. But to take corrupt people and force you into signing a fear factor plea agreement, if you don't take this, we're going to burn you to this. Oh, by the way, we're going to put the habitual criminal on you. The habitual criminal in Nevada was established by Harry Reid, it was adopted by federal stuff and by other states. Harry Reid in 1971 through 1973, he was the president of the Senate. Harry Reid formed the Committee on Conference. Pardon me?
He said also an attorney.
Yeah, he was an attorney.
Oh, yeah.
But Harry Reid never got proper authority to administer and put into law the Enhancement Acts and the Habitual Criminal Acts. So all these people that have been put in prison on these habitual criminal acts, they all constitutionally fail because they can't produce the taking of the yeas and nays and the reading on the three several days in both houses that are required by the constitutions. That's right. They are in violation of Article 4, Section 17 and Article 4, Section 23. And I'm going to get into that. Now, if you look at the judicial branch of government, they're never going to allow any filer to expand the record. It would mean the release of thousands of unlawful and unconstitutional withheld prisoners. And that includes all the foreigners in the state and everything else. What they need to do is take the foreigners back over to ICE and say, send them on back. We're going to release them now. We're done. Now, that would save hundreds of millions of dollars to the state.
I'm sorry, repeat that, Ben.
Oh, they do have ICE detainers on them. But they're also sitting there where they could exercise that ICE detainer immediately rather than serve out a sentence of a statute in the law that unlawfully and unconstitutionally fails, which holds them in prison against their will. Now, if I'm holding you in prison against your will by an unlawful and unconstitutional statute, what is that? Is that not a form of kidnapping? Well, we have all the documents to show them to you, and we're going to get them to you. Well, Vinny, you can't do that because Basic Law 101 of the ex post facto doctrine will stop you and put an estoppel. So what you got to do, you got to say, let's go to common law and then let's go forward and develop the Nevada Advanced Statute for the 21st century. And I'll give you an example. A guy walks into a grocery store. He looks around and he slips some lotion down his pants and he goes to walk out. Now, that's not burglary. That's shoplifting.
Correct.
But in Nevada, it's burglary. And you get a much heavier sentence for burglary than you do shoplifting.
You certainly do.
There's a guy that took a Rika vacuum cleaner, I know this personally, out of Walmart, and the judge gave him 25 years.
For a vacuum cleaner.
Does that make economic sense?
No.
And they got the vacuum cleaner back, and it was a cherry. There was nothing wrong with it. Now,
the whole idea of putting a person in jail for 25 years for petty petty larceny is absolutely obscene.
Vinny, under Gideon versus Wainwright, Clarence Gideon was an illiterate, frail, and humble man. He was very illiterate. He couldn't read or write. He went to prison in Florida under Gideon versus Wainwright. They made movies about him. ABC did a movie about him. And Clarence Gideon was incarcerated in Florida prison, and he was able to free or get new trials for 4,300 inmates in Florida prisons. And as a result of Gideon's work, which was taught to him by his cellmate, was a lawyer doing life who had killed a judge and his wife for caught him in bed together. And he killed both of them. He's doing life without. But the lawyer taught Clarence how to read and write and how to read law. And as a result of Gideon's work and research, he single-handedly changed the whole entire judicial system in Florida. I plan to free up or get new trials for 8,000 inmates in Nevada, nonviolent and others evaluated as non-threats to public safety. And when doing that, we're going to save the citizens and the taxpayer over $2 billion, where we can develop mental illness programs, and we can develop job training, and we can develop forms of distinguish between drug addictions and everything else that really works, so that when you put a person back on the street, the recidivism rate in Nevada is unbelievable. It's staggering. Let me give you an example. All you have to do is be walking down the street and you're on parole. First of all, parole is nothing more than a bed move. People don't understand that. They need to understand that parole is a bed move. It is designed to fail. So you're walking down the street and you're not bothering anybody, not doing nothing, and a police officer pulls over and he says, "Hey, you, come here." You walk over to him, he says, "Let me see your ID." You give me an ID, he checks you out, and he finds out you're on parole. You know what he does? He said, they said, bring you in. That is an altercation. You go back to prison immediately for something you never even did, but because the police officer made an altercation. That is shameful. It's designed not to work.
I've learned that almost everything is possible in Nevada.
Did you hear what he said? Almost everything is possible in Nevada.
Well, now we're going to, that brings
now,
us down.
Now, isn't there a money thing that these people are getting paid to keep dumping people in jail?
Well, they not only do that, let me tell you about these prisons, why they're built in these different counties. People don't realize that the Legislative Council Bureau, which is that fourth level of government that we're going to talk about.
The shadow
running,
government.
The
yeah.
shadow government that's running this state. They also control the Consensus Bureau. And each one of those beds has a number on them in the prisons in these counties. And they vote their vote without them even knowing they're voting their vote. Now think about that. So these prisons are built in these counties to control votes also that they don't tell you about. Now Prison News did a whole article about it. They did their research and in-depth studies. And that is how I became aware of the Consensus Bureaus and how they operate and why these prisons are being built specifically in these counties. And you look at all these prisons being bussed all the way across the country in Nevada. It takes a day's ride to get from here to northern Nevada. And they're bussing them back and forth and transferring them and moving them all around and changing the beds and changing the numbers. And they're controlling all these consensus votes. But we'll save that for another time, Anthony.
Definitely.
I want to move toward, through the pursuit of my actual innocence, I discovered years of gathered research of irrefutable evidence and factual proof that the Nevada revised statutes failed from the creation and inception, and they are illegal and unlawful, unconstitutional, invalid, and void. And they're void ab initio, Vinny. Now see, through the passage of time, Vinny, judges, DAs, lawyers, legal scholars in the three branches of government, they all operated on the presumption of law. They presumed, i.e., that the Nevada revised statutes were constantly created and legally and lawfully created, and that all statutes of Nevada were repealed. Now, what they did is about to shock you, and I'm going to get right into this. So I titled this on September the 5th of 2016, which is about to be released to world media, that O.J. Simpson is clueless that he is unlawfully and unconstitutionally imprisoned in Nevada by failed NRS statute laws that were hidden for decades of stealth fraud and the ongoing long arm fraud. Now, Vinny, the ongoing long arm fraud is this. What they did in 1951, and I'm going to get into all the meat of it and disclose who did it and why they did it, affects prisoners today in 2016. That's where the long arm fraud continues and comes into play. Now, they can argue latches and they can say, well,
These statues were created in 1951, and they've gone and gone on and on and on, and therefore latches occur. Well, I take you to the case of Anthony Lyons versus the state. Anthony Lyons went into a casino, and all he did was put his money in a slot machine and start pulling the lever. They gave Anthony Lyons, coerced him into signing a plea agreement, 4 to 10 years for handle popping. Handle popping. Well, Anthony Lyons wound up at Southern Desert Correctional Center where I was at, and he met a pro se litigant similar to me. And the litigant said to him, I think there's something wrong with the statute they put you in prison on. Well, they went in, they researched it, and they found out that the statute was just vague. It dealt with machine manipulations versus handle popping. And Anthony Lyons filed his appeals and everything else, and as a result, the Battle of the Supreme Court reversed Anthony Lyons' case and ordered his immediate release. After he'd done signed a plea agreement for 4 to 10 years for handle popping. Just a regular Joe going into the casino, popping the machine.
So now all these people here, now this is what happens here in Knight County. The key thing the public defender says is, if you don't take this plea agreement, you're going to rot here for 18 months before we get you to trial. No talking about bail, no nothing. So all these people taking plea agreements, and now they can't appeal their case to the Supreme Court. But because of these NRSs being fraudulent, they could do it.
Oh, let me tell you, the court never had subject matter jurisdiction to proceed, and subject matter jurisdiction can be raised 50 years from now. Now, the point that I'm getting to Anthony Lyons is, 34 years had passed when they discovered that NRS statute was just vague. 34 years later. So, if a statute can be discovered 34 years later, what's the difference between 34 years and 60 years? You see where I'm coming from? So, any of these DAs that want to yell latches, or some DA told Anthony the other day that, because it's all a long time, you know, they put it all out there, it's okay.
Yeah,
no, it's not okay.
Yeah, the DA turned around and told us Saturday that they've been using these statutes for this period of time, so we're just going to keep doing it because they're legal now.
Listen, any person, I don't care, judge or otherwise, goes against the Nevada Constitution or a federal constitution and is involved in the destruction of it, is committing treason and tyranny and usurpation and even perjury of their own oath of office under their oath and swear. And if they are to presume...
You're coming in real low, Vince, so you got to speak up.
Yeah, no law to be considered legal unless it's passed by legislature.
That's right.
Yeah, he just said no law can be considered legal and passed by legislature. Our NRS has been passed by legislature?
Well, there's a problem with that.
Okay.
And I'm going to get into it now, and now you're about to hear the meat of it.
Okay, we got 10 minutes.
I'm about to address to you the biggest legal find in Nevada history. After the gathering of 8 years of the solid ongoing research, absolutely we can now prove the irrefutable evidence of factual proof. We have in our possession shepherdized case laws. For the folks who don't know what that is, that means that's a case law that sets a precedence that's pretty hard to defeat. Is that not right, Vinny?
That is correct.
All right. Thank you. We also have Attorney General Opinion 85 in our favor, and it states very clearly that a joint concurrent resolution, even if it was passed by both houses, if it does not contain the enactment language, it cannot be cited as the laws of Nevada. And folks, we have joint concurrent resolution number one, number two in our possession, and it does not have the enactment language on its face. Now, that's the only first failure. In addition, we have the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals justice opinions on this. We have a law historian and book author named Charlie Wiseman, who wrote The Authority of Law and exposes Nevada on page 17 and many officials from the decades past to the present day. Okay? Now, when you look at Governor Sandoval, former Attorney General Kathleen Cortez Masto, Senator Harry Reid, and the other tyrants of the attorney usurpation and perjury of their own oaths of office, including the Clark County District Attorney Steve Wilson, and even former Judge Jackie Glass, many of the 8th Judicial District Court judges like Kathleen Delaney, Michael Pilotti, they all committed perjury and oath and swear, and signed by these officials under their signature pains and penalties of perjury. And if they are to presume that the NRSs are valid, it's these own NRS statutes that we've been able to do the research on and gather all the evidence that each one of them should be fined $5,000 and 4 years in jail, and none of them have any immunity. Now, I can show you all the facts on that, all the research is done. And we even sent them a warning with all that on it. And we sent them a copy of their oaths of office. And incidentally, there's several of these judges sitting on the bench that have even signed an oath of office, and therefore they have no bond, and they have no right to sit on the bench legally and constitutionally and lawfully.
So, Vin, now you know why Lane doesn't have a bond, because he never signed his oath of office.
Well, let me tell you about Judge Robert Lane and Wonker. There's two cases that we put before them right now on these NRS statutes, and they didn't want to touch this hot potato, and they denied them. They denied them. And they wrote the most bogus crap you've
ever
seen.
So they denied to hear the case.
That's right. They denied deceptive jurisdiction. Didn't want to touch it. So then it goes up to the Nevada Supreme Court. Nevada Supreme Court goes, oh, we ain't touching this. We ain't accepting jurisdiction. So then I file against Ross Miller, and we file against William Horn. And I helped another litigant do that. And so the Attorney General didn't represent the legislative William Horn, or didn't represent the Secretary of State. Guess who did? Keith Powers, the Chief Litigating Counsel for the Legislative Council Bureau.
That's the shadow government, Vin.
Now, he wrote in a document that I know he wished to get back called a brief. And in that brief on page 27, he made a statement. He said, it's real simple. If the citizens are asleep on their rights, the old maximum saying goes, you snooze, you lose. Now, how do you think the citizens are going to like that? This is from the Chief Litigation Counsel of the LCB, Keith Powers. Now, let me go on here.
We're going to have to do a whole show just on the LCB.
Oh, I got it all for you.
This is absolutely
ominous. Yeah, Benny, Benny, actually, I sent to you by accident because I thought I would send it to Anthony. The synopsis that's going out to the media and everything that's in there, I gave Anthony the domino effect and explained to him and gave him all the exhibits of all the documents that shows why the NRS is from their creation. Now, I went to the creation inception. Now, listen to this. Judge Robert Lane and Judge Wonker, they came back and denied these people the Willings petitions, saying that they were arguing because the NRS statute didn't have the enactment language on its face. They ain't their argument at all. They never said that. But that's why they claim they denied it. That ain't what they said. They said they went to the joint concurrent resolution that was used to repeal all the statutes, commingle all the things and violate the single subject rule, Article 4, Section 17, and then violate Article 4, Section 23, that the enactment language was not on the joint concurrent resolution. It was used with a copy of an engrossed bill. Remember this, folks. It wasn't an authenticated bill. It was a copy of an engrossed bill called Senate Bill Number 2 that they used to create and repeal the statute of Nevada and create the Nevada Revised Statute. It was never an authenticated bill. And under Chapter 385 of page 733, Section 2, and page 734, Section 4, the copy of the engrossed bill does not identify itself properly as the bill, the mode, the style, everything it has to have. It does not identify any of that on there. And therefore, under the laws of Nevada in that statute book, they all fail.
What do you think about that, Vin?
I'm astonished.
You hear that? Did you hear what he said?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
In addition to that,
there's a guy with 37 years of law enforcement and investigation.
Now, they thought they could fix the copy of the engrossed bill by attaching a joint concurrent resolution titled Number 1, Number 2, that they used to repeal the statutes and create the new statutes. Oh, incidentally, in there, they congratulated Russell W. McDonald. They claim he was a Nevadian-born citizen. No, the man was not a Nevadian-born citizen. He was born in Prosser Creek, California in 1917. The lawyer was behind all this with the judges. Then we checked and they found out that Oxford never showed that he was ever a Rhodes Scholar. And then we have no real proof that he graduated from Stanford University. So we think the man was a fraud that entered the government and ran the government. And not only did he wear that hat, but after he came the director of the Statute Revision Commission in 1951, appointed by the legislature, incidentally, the LCB puts out propaganda claiming that the Nevada Supreme Court created the Statute Revision Commission in 1951. So now you got a contravention going on there, right? They're putting out all this propaganda. But we've got documents to prove the legislature.
About, what did you say about the Supreme Court, Vin?
The Nevada Supreme Court has no authority.
Well, wait till you see the documents that Vinny has. They claim they do. And we're going to show, because those three justices were getting $6,500 a piece. And every time they came and made a bill or a resolution, they built themselves in for more money. You just wait till the citizen sees all this crap that went on. But in July 1st of 1963, they abolished the Statute Revision Commission. They transferred all the legislative power and authority to the Legislative Council. Who do you think the Legislative Council was? The same guy who was the director of the Statute Revision Commission, Russell W. McDonald. Now, Russell W. McDonald, after he got all that power and stripped the legislature, he takes the Legislative Council and makes it a division of the Legislative Council Bureau. Then he becomes the director of the Legislative Council Bureau. Then they enter into a private contract, non-service contract, with what's called the Legislative Committee to insulate him directly from the three branches of government. And they took Democrats and Republicans and they put them on the board. And even Kirkpatrick entered the picture at that time, okay? And she entered the picture, and they all sit on this board, Harry Reid and all of them, and they have a contract, a private contract, with the Legislative Council Bureau, who writes, rewrites bills and everything else and changes them to put the citizens at a disadvantage in this state.
We are down to 1 minute. How do you want to close this, and what are we going to talk about next week?
Well, we're going to talk about the presumption of law versus the knowledge of law.
Okay.
And we're going to give the citizens the knowledge of law, and we're going to defeat the presumption that all these judges are operating
so
under.
So do you think that everybody in Knight County that has a case going on needs to have it put on hold until this gets straightened out?
I think we're going to have federal intervention, and we're going to have to get it straight because the corruption's too deep.
Vinny's saying the next step would be federal intervention.
Well, you'd be happy to know that there's a lot of people that are citizens of New York incarcerated in Nevada prisons and jails that gives the right of the Attorney General's office in New York to be able to cross barriers and come over into the jurisdiction of Nevada and say, hey, I have seen a case where a federal judge in another state ordered the release of an inmate up in Nevada, up in NNCC. The warden wouldn't release him, so they sent the U.S. Marshals in. Not only that, they cuffed everybody on the yard, all the guards, and marched him off the yard. They replaced him with part of the National Guard and U.S. Marshals, and they took that man out of there, and then they brought these people back 5 days later.
All right. We have to stop right now. We will be back. An hour is definitely not enough. We will be back here next week, the same time, with even more stuff. I'd like to thank everybody for listening, and we'll talk to you next week.